Good morning, everyone. I'm not sure who is Indy Fancy Face. I don't recognize your handle there, but glad you're here. Thank you for joining me today. I am Joyce Glass. Rachel, so glad you're here. I am Joyce Glass. I'm a writer and speaker, for those that may not know me. And I have a ministry called the Daily GPS. It's GPS stands for Grow, Pray, Serve. And today we're here for a Faith-Filled Friday. And as you see, I'm getting all situated still. Probably should look in the camera. Thank you for the heart there before I get started. But anyways, I'm glad you're here today. We're going to talk about iRebel. Speaking of rebellion. So I don't know, for those of you that don't know, probably don't know that I have written a book called I Need God, Daily Downloads for Your Heart. This is the devotional I wrote, and I'm in the process of getting into print our second one, I Need God, Daily Downloads for Mom's Heart. So that will be available in November. But today we're going to talk a little bit about from I Need God, Daily Downloads for Your Heart. And if you haven't read the book, that's okay. This is not a follow along with a book session. It is just I'm taking some content from the book each week and going to share it. So today we're going to talk about rebellion. Have any of you ever rebelled against God, your parents, maybe a spouse, or just in general at work? Maybe you've rebelled. I know that I have. As a teen, I was not a rebellious child in the sense of constantly getting into trouble kind of thing. I was the kid that snuck around and did things. So most people thought I was the good girl, but the good girl didn't always obey her parents or her teachers or even God. So I had a little rebellion in me, like all of us. And that was you too. Yes. So, and I think in that stage, it's normal because we are trying to find out, you know, our limits on what we can and can't do, what is good for us. This shirt's bothering me. but we need to find out, you know, why. I was one of these, tell me why I can't do this and give me a good reason. And then I would most likely obey more readily than just telling me not to. Just don't. And if my mother watches this, she will probably wholeheartedly agree because she was there and dealt with me. And so she knew what it was like. But rebellion is where we all start in our faith walk with God. And that's why I started the first week of I Need God, I talk about rebellion. And I don't know if you're familiar with the story of King David and Bathsheba, but if you look in 2 Samuel chapters 11 and 12, those two chapters talk in great detail about David's rebellion. He went, first of all, he didn't go where he was supposed to go. He was supposed to be out fighting with the other men in the army in the battle. He was supposed to be leading the military. And he decided, for whatever reason, to stay back. And when he did, that's when he got into some big trouble. He decided that he wanted the woman that he saw one day bathing. And he had her brought to her house. Now, the interesting thing about this, to his house, excuse me. The interesting thing about this, okay, think about this. David had how many wives at this point? I mean, I don't really, can't remember the number. I don't even know if it gives the number. But he had many wives at this point. But instead of going and seeking to be with one of his many wives, he decides to take Uriah's wife, Bathsheba. And it was one of those, I call it the pit. He fell into the slippery, slimy pit that all of us can fall into. I mean, I know I've fallen into the pit more times than I care to count. even as a mature Christian, we can still fall into the pit. And I know that I have, just through deception of the enemy, thinking, oh, this isn't so bad, and you go a little further, and this isn't so bad, and you go a little further. And it is bad. It is bad, because when we're rebelling against God, when we're not following His word, when we're not being obedient, then we're not following where He wants us to go. So is L.L. Marsh my cousin Lisa? Not sure if that's Lisa or not, but if it is, hello. Let's see if it says. Yes, it is. Hello, Miss Lisa. I love you, my cousin. Yes, good. But we're talking about rebellion today, and Lisa has a teenage son, the same age as mine, but hers is already out of college, and we could talk about rebellion quite a bit with our teens. So, thank you for the heart there, and I love you too. But what I was getting at is we all fall into the slippery slope. That's how we all start our Christian walk, is in rebellion. We finally, something either a pastor says, whoever's leading us to Christ says, somebody, you know, hello Kelly, somebody who leads us to Christ, whoever that may be. For me, it was my older sister. And good morning. And she really helped me get clear on becoming a Christian and accepting Christ. And it was interesting because, you know, I was very young and I loved God. And as a young child, you know, I haven't been gone to church since. Oh, awesome. Is Tony your brother? Are you that, Rachel? So anyway, oh, Tony introduced you again. I'm sorry, I was misunderstanding what you said. Tony's your best friend. Awesome. He is a good friend to have. Love Tony. And was that yes, he's your brother, or yes, he's your friend? Help me clarify that one, Rachel. But anyways, and Tony's another great example. Tony Adams is actually in week two. I interview him. And he talks about his life where he really, really rebelled against God. And he, okay, yes, you love him, not brother. Got it. So he has a sister, and I think her name is Rachel, but I may be wrong. You hung out with him during his wild days. So you were there. You know what I'm talking about then. And God got a hold of him. And I would love to hear your stories at some point, Rachel, too, how God got a hold of you. And God got a hold of him. And that's what God does for every one of us, whether we're little children or we're teenagers who are just living the wild life, or we're grown adults who've just wandered away from God. That's all in that state of rebellion. And God will come seek us, and He will find us. And in Tony's story, what I loved is this DA, it was his second DUI offense, I think, if I remember correctly, Rachel. If you know the story, help me here. And he had already been to rehab and fell off the wagon, got in trouble again. I think he got in trouble while he was on probation, too, so that makes it, you know, double whammy trouble. But he went to jail. And in jail, but at that sentencing, the judge gave him another chance for some rehab. And I don't know if it was divine intervention from God, that I don't know if this, you know, judge was a Christian or not, or if just God was using him and speaking to him. But he gave Tony another chance with rehab. And Tony at that time finally started listening to God, and he had a what I call a come to Jesus meeting in jail with God. And you know, I've had many come to Jesus meetings. You don't have to be in jail, and the trouble that we get into sometimes for me is more in my heart. It's my attitude, it's my the way I'm viewing things is where God has to get a hold of me sometimes. And I'll give you an example. With the church we're attending now, when we first started attending it, I hated the music. I love music. I love contemporary Christian music. And this music was nothing like that. And I hated it. And I would get this, the very critical spirit. I would be critiquing what people wore, what they said, how they sang, you know, all this stuff in my head during church service. And finally, God said, Joyce, it is 20 minutes once a week. And the rest of the time, you can listen to whatever you want. But during this time, just focus on me and not the music. And God, it's funny, isn't it? God got a hold of me because I had a very, very critical spirit. It was not what I wanted. It's not what I wanted to do. It's not what I wanted to be and blah, 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 blah. But my husband liked it and my son wanted to go and they had a good youth group. And so, and he became friends and he's actually graduating in a little over a week. And he is still friends with those kids that from 6 years ago or 7 years ago, actually. And I'm so glad we stayed. And we got a new music minister for a little while that was more contemporary, thank the Lord. And then we got another music minister. The one that we really liked resigned last May for another opportunity he felt God leading him to. And since then, we've had Al Denson as our interim music minister. Now, you may have no clue who Al Denson is. Back in the 90s, he was a contemporary Christian artist, but he was releasing albums then, touring, you know, singing, and he was doing a lot, and he was on the radio a lot. And I remembered his name and some of his songs, but he wasn't like high on my radar then. Well, he is now our interim music minister, and he does a fabulous job. He comes from Dallas, Texas every week to Albany, Georgia to work with our church. Part of that is because he's friends with our associate pastor, and he did it at first for just 3 weeks. He said, I'll do it for 3 weeks, help you all out till you can get an interim minister in there. And then he's been there since last July. Exactly. Wow. So, and working with him, I mean, it's fabulous. And you can look back in my Facebook pictures and see we went to his ranch back in February. Oh my goodness, we had the best time. We got muddy. We learned how to harmonize. We, grew together as a praise team. It was the praise team and the ministers from the church all went. The ministers were having a ministers meeting while we, the praise team, were working together, learning how to harmonize and other things. And he just really took some time to work with us. And that's amazing. That's, a great hand of God. Now, see, if I hadn't stayed, if I had had my way and left, I would have missed out on the opportunity to work with Al Denson. And what I love about him is he actually helps each of us to learn solos. He helps us as a team. Last week for Mother's Day, we did this really cool special thing and everybody loved it. All the ladies on the praise team, there were 6 or 7 of us, sang. The only one lady did not sing. Her daughter died 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, something like that. So, that was obviously hard for her being Mother's Day, and this is the first Mother's Day without her. And so, of course, she did not sing, but it was all the ladies, and everybody in the church loved it. When each of us had different parts we sang, some, had solos for different verses and different songs, and then we did this poem that, oh my goodness, we all choked up. It's a poem of appreciating mothers of all different kinds, those that have lost babies, those who wanted to have a baby and haven't been able to have a baby, those who, have children, but they're difficult, or the children have walked away. Al found this article that had this, I guess you call it like a poem in it, and we read this poem out. Each of us took turns saying a couple lines. And we all choked up because this is also the first Mother's Day. Our pastor's mother died in December. So this is his first Mother's Day without his mom. And his wife was standing next to me, and she had to say the one about grieving the loss of a mother. So it's wonderful. And all of that to say, if I had my way, if I had continued on with my rebellion and been in my critical spirit and God had not got a hold of me, I would have missed many, many blessings, at this church. And so I'm glad that I stayed and I listened and I finally became obedient in my heart. That's where I am more rebellious, is in my heart. Not so much in an outward way, you know, lashing out at people kind of thing, or doing rebellious activities, you know, that is not me, but I struggle with my heart. I don't know if either one of you struggle with your heart. But what I loved about David is he made a royal mess out of his life. And I'm sure you can relate. He went and slept with Bathsheba. Then she found out she was pregnant. And yes, he does. God loves broken people. Thank you, Rachel. And he, after he slept with her, found out she was pregnant, he brought Uriah back from the battlefield thinking he could convince him to go sleep with his wife. Well, Uriah is a man of integrity, and he could not, in good conscience, go sleep with his wife when he knows his friends were out on the battlefield and he wasn't there. So David tried to get him drunk and have a party to get him to go sleep with his wife. Nothing would work. So finally, what I find the most amazing part of what David did, the most, it's one of those, it's hard to believe he did it. He wrote a letter to, I believe his name was Joab, was the king of the commander of the army, and told him to put Uriah in the front lines and then everybody to pull back so Uriah would get killed. He gives Uriah the letter, closed up, to give to Joab. Could you imagine carrying your own death sentence to your commander? I mean, obviously Uriah had no idea, but that's what happened. And I just find it, I don't understand how David in good conscience could do that to Uriah. But he did, and he was trying very hard to cover his tracks. So when Uriah was killed on the battlefield, Uriah wasn't the only one. That's the problem. When we try to cover up sin, we hurt more than one person. We hurt many people. And Uriah and others were killed in the battle because of David's command to do this. So it wasn't just Uriah who died. There were others who died that day because of this action. Then David decides, okay, I'll make Bathsheba my wife and I'll comfort the poor little grieving wife, is what he's portraying to the world, that he's bringing her in to be his wife as a comfort for her and to protect her, because, you know, in that society, women needed that kind of protection. They didn't have any rights. They didn't have property, those kinds of things. So he was helping her. And actually, obviously, he was helping himself. But then, finally, he is confronted. His rebellion is confronted by Nathan the prophet. And that's what I'm going to talk about next week. Is somebody, either God will confront us somehow, you know, either through a scripture, through someone else, through our own, you know, through time with God, or just that own conviction will finally come upon us. Because we can get our heart so hardened to God that we can't hear him. We can't listen to him. And that's painful when we can't listen to God, because we don't know what we're missing when we can't listen to God. So next week we're going to talk about I repent. But what I, your teen is going through that, not listening to God. And I'm not so sure that mine is not either. You know, I know that he loves God. He can't hear him. But I don't think he's seeking God. And that's what's really bothering me as a mom, as of a son who's about to graduate from high school. I really want him to start seeking God, because I know this is the time your faith is going to be challenged in ways that you could never imagine. Exactly. And I'll be praying for your teen, Rachel. Is that a boy or a girl? I forgot what you said, if it was a boy or a girl. But let me know which one it is, if it's a boy or girl, and I'll pray for them. I don't have to know their name. Elijah, boy. Okay. Definitely, we'll be praying for Elijah. And obviously, anybody who hears this, pray for them. So, next week, we're going to talk about repentance. You're welcome. But today, one other thing that I wanted to invite you is I do blog at thedailygps.com. And prayer is the best way to stay connected with God. And there's always lots of people and things to pray for. And I have created this prayer planner. So if you go there today, thedailygps.com, and subscribe to be on my email list, you will get the prayer planner for free. And that will help in organizing your prayers. Next week, I'm going to try to make sure I have a copy to show you. I meant to have one this week and I forgot. But I want to invite you to do that, thedailygps.com. Subscribe to the email. I only email like once every week, or at the most maybe every 2 weeks. So you're not going to be getting a ton of emails from me every day. That's not my style. But I do like to encourage and inspire Christians every day. That is my mission and my hope. And so I encourage and inspire Christians through my blog and now through Periscope. And Rachel, I appreciate you being here today. I hope you have a wonderful day. You can find me on Facebook. There's Joyce Glass writer and speaker page. And then you can friend me as well. Joyce Glass, I live in Leesburg, Georgia. So I look forward to getting to know all of you better. You're welcome, Rachel. And I will be praying for Elijah, and you can pray for my son too. And I appreciate it and look forward to seeing everyone again next week for Faith-Filled Friday. And we're going to be talking about I Repent, which is week 2 of my book. And again, you don't have to have read the book to be able to involved in the Periscope. Like I said, I'm just pulling content from it. But if you want to read the book, obviously you can, and you can go to iNeedGodBook.com to learn more about I Need God. Hope you have a great day, and thank you.